This is a Media Lab podcast. Welcome to Putting It Together, the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-described Sondheim expert. We are finishing up our Candide chat here today. I invited on Brendan Clifford. He is a fascinating guest to have here on the show, which you will soon hear about. He was involved in a production of Candide that was put on in New York. I will say that because I, as I mentioned last week, that I am very new to the world of Candide. It was something that I didn't really ever engage with. Most because I believe the people that told me that it was bad. Sondheim had nothing to do with it, or very little to do with it. And I have to say, I think that the music is fantastic. So if you are like me and have never really delved into Candide before, I think you should. I think you should watch a few clips on YouTube, find one of the cast albums that's available on streaming, and see what happens, because I am kicking myself for not listening to this score sooner. But let's get into the show. The third song that Sondheim wrote lyrics for was a song called This World.
Everyone is massacred. Maximilian, the Baron, Paquette, and Pangloss himself. The Baroness is cut in pieces. Cunegonde raped repeatedly before she is bayoneted to death. Among the ruins, Candide searches for her corpse.
Brendan Clifford, thank you so much for joining me here today.
Thank you so much for having me. It's an honor.
Let's start off with, like, what got you into Sondheim in the very first place?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I guess you could say I was a theater kid from early on in my life. But what got me into Sondheim was, I think initially I saw a production of Company at a high school. I was in eighth grade, and that we were doing one of those spend a day at the high school and things that I guess a lot of high schools do for their incoming younger people, eighth grade in the part of Connecticut, and in Connecticut, part of America that I grew up in. And they had a very, that town was very culturally alive, I guess is the word I would use, like where the football team and the theater club were the same kind of importance to the town and the school. And so they had a very robust theater program with lots of talent, and they had a student theater program, and they were allowed to be daring. And so they did, you know, they did a lot of really fun things that schools would never normally allow. But one of them was Company.
That's so fascinating to me. Like, do you know if that was like full version of the Company, or do they have to?
It was
like
the full version.
God,
they
okay.
did. They did one number. They did You Could Drive a Person Crazy for, maybe they did more than that, but that's the one I remember as like a preview for us incoming eighth graders. And then I went to see the actual production, and I'll never forget that in the preview, they said when April and whoever are like, he's a blank, you know, son of a bitch, like when they're bashing Bob being part of it, they said asshole in it. And I know some versions in the professionally use that and some don't. And I don't even remember if the original was that, had that curse in it or not, but they used asshole. And I was like,
ooh, okay. Like risque.
I am here, and I am hearing asshole in a musical production at this school. So I went to see it, and I was blown away. And it was done in 60s style, as I recall, like they said it in the time. And it was just like, it was just a crazy thing. I bought a VHS recording of it. The school was so into their productions, they had them and sold them to people, whether they saw the shows or not. And I had also bought shows I hadn't seen. But so that blew my mind. And then I had a group of friends who would throw these Sweeney Todd parties, and where they had like cakes with Sweeney Todd, you know, in the icing and stuff, or meat pies. I never actually went to one of them, but I was so, one of them brought me the CD, or showed it to me. He probably just had it. And I looked at one of the photos of the production in the liner notes, and I was like, my mind just went all these places. And interestingly to me, this, when I finally watched the Lansbury Hearn VHS, it was not at all like what I imagined from the photo, but it was, let's say it was even better. I don't know what I thought it was going to be anymore, but so Company and then Sweeney Todd blowing my mind as like a 13, 14 year old.
Amazing.
I just got into the whole Sondheim thing.
Initially, when you said Sweeney Todd party, I'm like, is that just a weird way of saying key party? I'm like, oh, no, they actually had Sweeney Todd parties. Okay, great.
They murdered people. I don't want to be coy about that. They murdered people and baked them. Right.
It was a great night, great way to spend a Friday night. So I know we're talking about kind of this weird oddity in Sondheim's career in a way, because it's not him writing music, it's him coming in and just writing the lyrics. But what is... Do you have any type of relationship with Candide at all?
I do. I feel very lucky to have a Candide relationship. I mean, my original relationship with it was the original cast recording, which was one of the countless ones I went to the library and checked out and made a recording of for myself. And they had that original recording, which is still my favorite recording by far.
Which doesn't have any of the Sondheim stuff on it. We should be very clear.
Which is both fine, and I like the Sondheim editions very much, but I'm fine without them there as well. But the performance of the score, the cast of the score, it leaves out some numbers I wish were there from the original song list too. But you know, when you're first listening to it, you don't know that. I fell absolutely in love with the score from that album, and so that was always in my head. And then when I was in college, I had an opportunity to be an assistant director to Lonnie Price on his production at Avery Fisher Hall that was broadcast on PBS with starring Kristen Chenoweth and Patti LuPone of the more famous elements of the cast. Starred many other people, but those were the two we really care about.
what was that like? Like, what was your day-to-day role for that production?
It's an assistant director role can vary from production to production and what the person needs. Lonnie tends to have several assistant directors. Mm-hmm. And so I was one of them. And so it was, you know, helping set up or running errands or, you know, taking notes on staging or on performance. I worked with him on a couple of shows. So that was the first one. So a lot of it started out as just getting into the mix and observing and folding myself into his world and the rehearsal process. But it was a fairly quick rehearsal process. And it was a staged concert, which is a lot of his shows are that, but they tend to be full performances just under the guise of a staged concert. But they're, you know, even with a trimmed book, they're pretty much full production. And for anyone who's seen that, you can buy this performance on DVD, you can probably rent it from libraries at least, or on streaming. And I think it pops up on YouTube in full or in parts, depending on who's taking it down at different times. I had the time of my life working on it.
When did that production go on? What year would that have been?
I'm gonna guess 2003 or 4. I'm gonna look it up for a moment. At least before January 2005. So sometime in 2004, I think.
By the way, I should just point out, we were talking before we officially pushed record on this about some of the stuff that's going on at Theater Calgary. Lonnie Price holds a special place for me because a show that he directed here in Calgary, he actually came up to Calgary to direct a show, was the last thing I saw before everything got shut down.
What was it?
It was called The Louder We Get, which is a true story that's based here in Canada about a teenager who wanted to bring his boyfriend to prom in a Catholic school. It was a Catholic school that they were doing this, and they said no. The thing is about it is, like, the prom is like a big thing that happened on Broadway, so I don't know if that'll ever make its way to a Broadway stage in this show. Case, but I enjoyed it. There's actually a couple of great songs, I thought, that were in that show. Lonnie was there the night I went. He gave a little speech at the end and everything. So that was nice to see him live and in person. I know your answer to this already, because again, we already talked about this. But as far as like how you like the show Candide, you've already said you like the music. But as like a show, like as a theater piece, where are you at with that? Because I know that it can be kind of divisive for a lot of people.
I mean, you know, I feel like we're jumping a few steps in that, because the first question for me is where is the show when you're asking about it? Like, which version of it?
That's true.
I mean, the score, and I would say this from the original cast recording through all my favorite versions of it, you know, whether it's the full collection of songs or a smaller version, I think the music and the lyric, I think the score itself is one of the best and one of my favorites, period. But the only production I've ever seen that I really, really enjoyed all the way through was the one I worked on.
Right.
And perhaps I'm really biased in that, but I think that it was just a lot of fun. You know, mm-hmm. one has one's certain things they like or don't like. I would have passed on some of the mustard colored costumes for the chorus in the background. But other than that, I really thought it was just a joyful experience of the show and the Hugh Wheeler book or a trimmed version of it. I don't remember how much was trimmed from it, but I do remember that John Wideman came to see it, and I had been working with him. I left out my Sondheim experience includes that I've been very lucky to work on several Sondheim, mm-hmm. major Sondheim revivals, including around that same time, Assassins and Pacific Overtures on Broadway. So I was talking to John Wideman a lot, and he came to see it, and he said that it was one of the best he had seen because it was the closest in spirit to Hal Prince's production,
right.
The original Chelsea production, I think. You ask different people and they'll probably say different things about the spirit of his continued revivals of his revival. And I think some of the opera house productions don't have the same exact spirit as the Chelsea production, for better or worse. I don't know. I haven't seen the original or most of the others, but when I watch ones that are meant to be full productions, especially ones that take themselves seriously, it's like lead a lot of the time. And I don't think that one of the two productions that I'm aware of that you're focusing on, what is it? The Scottish opera production from 88.
Yeah.
That
roughly,
was
yeah.
broadcast. It's a beautifully sung production and played production, but you know, I find it kind of deadly. As I recall, I didn't watch it. I didn't watch the full thing in preparation for this again, but I have seen it. And I remember just wishing that it were the Bernstein conducted concert of it.
Yeah. I'm in a huge agreement with you. I think that, and again, I have also been told by people that they love that Scottish version. So
I don't get it. But I love the costume.
Yeah, put the little asterisks beside it because I'm not there. I think the standout is Anne Howard, I think is her name. Anne Howard is the old lady. But other than that, it's like this is a bit of a chore for me to get through. And then,
staging, no disrespect to Jonathan Miller, I think, but I don't think it was staged with very much dynamic or life. And I did see a full production at LA Opera that Kelsey Grammer starred in, as well as Christine Ebersole as the old lady. And again, similar issues, well performed, amazing orchestra performance, of course, at LA Opera, but Mary Zimmerman directed it, perhaps, I think, but I just didn't, I'm very curious how the Lillian Hellman book is, and I'm not curious enough to read it, even though I have a hard copy at home. I keep meaning to read it.
Right.
I'm not at home right now, so I didn't have a chance to look at it there. But I'm very curious if I'll like that book better. And I don't think Hugh Wheeler's book isn't good. It seems like, especially for what Hal Prince wanted to do with it, it was the right move all the way through. But I think it's a very particular kind of thing, and not everyone seems to understand the light comedy of it and the satire of it. And if you take it too seriously, as an opera company often seems to, it just falls.
I agree.
It's like
I think
that falls down on itself.
When I watched that Leonard Bernstein conducted concert version of 1990, I think is when that one was
87,
aired.
I think even
whenever that happened, like, there's this kind of light bulb, like, oh, it's funny. Like, that's what I finally was like, oh, these lyrics are actually funny. That one's really nice because the YouTube version actually has subtitles for when they sing. I'm like, okay, it's easier for me to pick up what they're actually saying here now. And I also love the fact that you get to see, like, Bernstein, like, bopping along to
his bopping
music.
Is such joy.
It's
great.
Yeah.
He begins it with this infectious injection, mm-hmm. and you just stay. If you're with it, you're with it, and it doesn't hurt having like Adolph Green as Pangloss,
Great casting of Pangloss, by the way. I think he's like perfect choice.
Yeah, my favorite of what I've seen. And no disrespect to Kelsey, who was who was nice in it too. Yeah. Very funny, if I remember. But
My problem is the book. And honestly, I think a lot of it is now, as in a 2021 context, what we consider to be like good writing and like setup and like payoffs and stuff, I don't feel it really even happens in this show. It's just like random scenes stitched together for satirical purposes, of course. But it also feels a little bit cheap to be like, oh, these characters died. Well, actually, they didn't. And then they died again. But, you know, actually, they didn't. And so after a while, it's like, okay, well, like nothing matters because they're just going to come back anyways, probably.
Yeah, it's I think the way that it is, the fact that it is adapted from the Voltaire is inherently a problem for so many productions, because even the book, I haven't read the Lillian Hellman original. I do my understanding of it, or my memory of my understanding about reading about it, was that it did made more decisions about what it was going to cover in the story rather than the Hal Prince Hugh Wheeler version, I think, tries to cover much more of the picaresque nature of the novella. And I think if you're packing that all in, but you also don't really know how to play the humor and move the staging along in a really zippy, fun, colorful way, you're just gonna, it may work as a novella. It doesn't really work for a modern audience going to a musical.
Right.
But I hope one day to direct one that does.
It does.
That does make
it
work.
We'll finally crack it.
Like Lonnie did, I think, and Hal did. There is actually, I just found this, and I don't know if you knew about it or if we are allowed to tell your audience, but there is on YouTube, there is a production, there is a broadcast of the original Hal Prince production recreated for New York City Opera and aired on Live at Lincoln Center in 1986, and it's directed by Hal and music.
I should check that out.
I'll send you the link. Yeah. It looks great. I only watched a couple of scenes, especially the ones relevant to the songs we're here to talk about. But it does feel like Lonnie's production more, and I think I'd like it a lot.
Because the interesting thing is because I now listen to a bunch of versions of Candide, because I was only focusing on the ones that actually had the Sondheim lyrics included. I have to admit, I have not listened to the original production of Candide, so I should do that. But I know.
Barbara Cook is winning right now.
I apologize, Miss Cook. But I really love that first Hal Prince production quite a bit, like just the sound of it. So if I can find that production broadcast, that'd be great.
Have you listened to his revival productions or cast recording?
The one with Jim Dale.
Daniel-y.
Yeah,
Jim Dale.
Yeah, that one I like quite a bit too. Yeah.
They're very different than the original.
They are. Maybe that's why I like it, because it just sounds a little bit different, but
I've never liked an old lady as much as I like the original, whose name I believe is Ira Patina. Something like that, and forgive me everyone if I've gotten it wrong or mispronounced it, but she's just so wonderful on that recording. And Barbara Cook, I don't think I've ever heard Cunegunda done better than Barbara Cook, because she understands the humor of it effortlessly, and she sings it effortlessly, other than Kristen Chenoweth in the production I got to work on, and not for that bias, but I do really wish there was a cast recording of it, because she is unbelievable as Cunegunda, and her Glitter and Be Gay, I think, is just under Barbara Cook's, and no one else comes close to those for me, for the comedy and the singing combination.
That's the thing, like, you're talking about two of the best who have ever done it, as far as being able to blend like beautiful singing but also be very funny at the same time. So,
and I think to some credit of their training and their world of Broadway and Broadway musicals rather than opera. You know, no disrespect to opera and opera performers, but I do think they don't train in communicating lyrics the same way. And it just is so evident when you hear Candide recording.
You know who would agree with you in that sentiment is Mr. Stephen Sondheim, because he has said the exact same thing. He's like, why I don't like opera very much is because they prioritize singing over performance. And he's like, I'd rather watch a better performer than a better singer in most musical theater roles. So...
I don't disagree, and we're very lucky with Kristen and Barbara that we get. Yeah. We don't have to choose.
Exactly. We don't have to choose. just going to break into the conversation here very rudely to tell you some additional information that I think everyone should know about. Number one, if you would like to help support the show for absolutely free, you can give a rating and review on whatever app you listen to podcasts in. I'm always appreciative of people who do that. And if you would like to help monetarily so that this show becomes better over time, you can head over to our Patreon page. Please do not donate if it impacts you negatively financially. I also need to give a huge thanks to the God That's Good tier from Patreon, the triumphant quartet of Jack, Todd, Barry, and Carrie. Of course, Putting It Together is also a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, locally grown, community supported. The Alberta Podcast Network promotes and supports Alberta-made podcasts and connects their audiences with Alberta-based businesses and organizations. This episode of Putting It Together is brought to you by the Calgary Foundation, proudly supporting community needs for 65 years. Empathy, kindness, generosity, we are united in our desire to give, to inspire hope, and transform the lives of people who are struggling in turbulent times. And the Calgary Foundation is here to help. From mental health programs to environmental causes, the Community Knowledge Center website features profiles of charitable organizations, all searchable by area of interest. Be inspired by compelling stories. Be informed of innovative work. Be responsive to the needs. To connect to hundreds of outstanding charitable organizations serving our community, visit ckc.calgaryfoundation.org. And to learn more about the Calgary Foundation, visit calgaryfoundation.org. I realize that our international listeners probably have little to no reason to do that, but I would still kind of give them a check to see exactly the benefit that an organization like that can have in a community and see the great work that they're doing in my city that I live in. Well, here's another sponsor that, again, our international listeners have less than any reason to ever check out, but I'm going to say it anyways because they are helping to support this show. We are brought to you this week by Park Power, your friendly local utilities provider in Alberta, offering internet, electricity, and natural gas with low rates, awesome service, and profit sharing with local charities. That's probably my favorite part. In Alberta, you get to choose who to buy your internet, electricity, and natural gas from. Park Power has low overhead, which in turn allows them to offer low competitive rates. Reach out for a no-obligations comparison by emailing estimates at parkpower.ca. If you decide to switch, it's easy. It's really just a change to your billing, and you can feel good knowing you are helping to give back to our communities with your utilities bill. Learn more at parkpower.ca. So we're talking about two songs here today. The first one is This World, which this is right after Cunegonde dies again, I believe, or at the very least, his master has died and he's been flogged. So he's starting to give up his idea of optimism in the world.
I can't remember if I don't know for sure where if it changes from production to production, but at least in the Hal Prince in this restaging of his original that I just found, it comes after the auto de fe when I guess Cunegonde is killed again.
Exactly. Yeah.
And in another production, I think it might come. Well, I don't know, because I guess This Must Be So is always coming after the original battle.
I think it would. Yeah.
But in the concert that we love so much, the Bernstein conducted one, it comes after a battle.
Correct. Yeah. So it's in a different spot, kind of. Regardless, this world is him losing faith in humanity. Like, that's what part of the biggest thing here, right? Is like, there was this whole idea about optimism back in Voltaire's time, and he was like, not about it at all. So part of Candide is just like a satire on like, why having just only optimism in your life is maybe not the best way to do it. It was also wrapped up in Christianity and stuff like that. So he had the big problems with the church at the same time. So I'm going to break this up into three parts, and Candide starts off by singing, "Is this all then, this the world, death and envy, greed and blindness? What is kindness but a lie? What to live for but to die?
Is this all then, this the world, death and envy, greed and blindness? but to live for, but to die. I would.
So, what a life-affirming bit of lyrics there to read here on a Friday night when we record this. But what do you have to say about that opening?
I mean, I say these lyrics to myself in the mirror every day.
great way to wake up in the morning, yeah.
I mean, I think that it's a fantastic, it's simple, and I think it does a beautiful job of saying what I assume Prince and Wheeler wanted stated there, which is this is Candide giving up on mm-hmm. optimism, giving up on hope. And the original, I don't know if we want to get into the version that these lyrics replaced, but it's also a beautiful lyric and is much more focused, I think, on his emotional reaction to Cunegonde and how it makes his heart feel, rather than like, okay, this is the final nail in the coffin, mm-hmm. You know, like happiness and whatever. You read the lyric.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess let's have that quick conversation, and you'll probably know better than I will. What is it that this replaces again?
It replaces Candide's lament. Right. And I guess this is, in some productions, this version is also known as Candide's lament, but just a different version of lyric to this song. Mm. And I think slightly longer, that is a little bit more poetic and not right. so starkly like an emotional reaction to philosophy.
Sure.
But you know, it ends with a more, I don't know, it's a beautiful notion of like, my heart is where Cunegonde is, like my heart is dead because she's dead, wherever she's gone, that is where his heart is now.
Yeah.
So it doesn't as clearly say I've given up on this, but it's a long song to state where his emotional mind is, I guess.
Yeah, but important too, I think, because I think within the show itself, right, because we're set up, we're introduced to these characters being like happy-go-lucky, and you kind of see them go through trial and tribulation consistently. And I think this is just showing, hey, Candide has reached his breaking point finally, right? Like, you can only have, you know, steadfast optimism for so long before it's like, you know what? People are being jerks and this isn't cool. And I'm not going to put a positive spin on this just because that's what a life philosophy happens to be.
Do you want me to read the original version of this song?
Yeah, go ahead.
You can keep it or not. So I think it's all Richard Wilbur. I don't know if John Latouche, how you say his name, is credited for this, but I'm not sure because it's, you know, Candide's everything is all over the place.
Everyone wrote everything. Yeah.
Yeah. I probably know Bernstein wrote most of it. Both of them start with the Cunegonde moaning. And then Cunegonde, is it true? Is it you so still and cold, love? Could our young joys just begun not outlast the dying sun? When such brightness dies so soon, can the heart find strength to bear it? Shall I ever be consoled, love? No, I swear it, by the light of this lover's moon, though I must see tomorrow's dawn, my heart is gone where you are gone. Mm-hmm. And then he repeats that last part.
Right. Those, I think, are good lyrics too, right? I think they're just going for two separate things. In traditional Sondheim style, of course, he wants to be even more bleak, I find, in his
lyrics. Certainly more bleak, yeah.
And a little bit less poetical as well. Do you prefer one over the other?
Well, I don't think I have a preference. I really do like them both, and I think they both serve a really they serve a function. But I find it interesting that in Bernstein's the conducted concert that he does, that's supposedly his final version of it, you know, for whatever that means. Obviously, he's not with us anymore to keep approving revisions. But he doesn't use the Sondheim lyrics, which were written prior to this concert being done.
Right.
He uses those original lyrics, so I guess in some senses I would defer to him since I like them both, but this is one of those, you know what, either way, it's like a Aubyn Underneath versus Story of Lucy and Jesse, whichever one works best for your production, I'm okay.
Just do it. Yeah. Well, he finishes off by saying, I would never miss the world, never this one, which is hateful. Let me die then, only grateful. Cunegonde, dying sooner, was spared this world. And then he reprises, what is kindness but a lie, and what to live for but to die?
I would never miss this world, never this one which is hateful.
It's so sadly bitter. And I do think maybe this is, it makes it my preferred version ultimately now that we're going further, because it's super effective to me that someone who is just dripping in optimism to a comedic level, if you're doing it right, is now turning on this bitter, like just really bitter and sad.
Yeah.
Like you've broken him. You've taken a innocent person who trusts and believes in what's good and has faith in humanity, and you've broken him. And that I do think is probably really necessary to the emotional journey you want the audience to go on. And it those are heartbreaking lyrics.
I know.
Being glad Cunegonde is dead just so that she wouldn't have to have this same realization.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, in a way this feels like, and I know I'm painting with a super broad brush here, but it almost makes me feel like, oh, is Sondheim Russian to be like this in despair? It's like, whatever, people are dead. It's better for them to be dead anyway. So like, but I'll continue on living. Like, that's basically what this feels like.
That's fair. Yeah. I mean, I haven't heard him accused of being Russian, but it's apt.
Yeah. I mean, I think this world is good, but you're right in saying like of the different versions that I have watched or read, like, they don't actually use this version all that much, interestingly enough. And in fact, they don't even really use his added lyrics to Auto de Fe very much either. Like, that's only for like the Hal Prince version, I think, that those actually show up in.
And I'm not sure, I'm not mad at that necessarily, to borrow a popular phrase, because I really love the original version of Auto de Fe.
Yeah.
But I love them both, and I haven't revisited the Sondheim lyrics enough because we weren't covering it, Kyle.
I know.
But they were in the production that I worked on, and they were a lot of fun there. So depending on how you're staging it, and I might take this all back when I look further at some of these productions, I think that the auto de fe is really effective when it's kind of scary, and if you're doing the funnier, more trivial version of lyrics, I think it can come off just sillier than it should be sometimes, but it can also be a really great balance of satire and consequence or gravity.
Right.
That music is so,
it's great. So I because you brought it up, I have to bring this up, which is, I have been re-listening to that Auto de Fe song so often over the last 2 weeks since I've been introduced to it. And I think it is partly because of the Bernstein bouncing up and down on that song in that concert version. He gets so happy when this song is playing, which is amazing because it's about people like reveling in people's death. Like, that's what the whole song is about.
Does that version use the Sondheim editions?
No, it does not. Not the concert version. No.
So that might be, my bias might be entirely because besides the original cast album, I found that PBS broadcast either on TV or at the library or whatever, and I watched it a lot, so I might
that tune is just so infectious. I keep thinking about it,
and it's got his classic kind of whistle, like,
that's right,
very West Side Story.
That's
there.
Right. Yeah, that it's interesting too, like, because like way back when I was talking about West Side Story, we mentioned how they're like, hey, there's some songs here that were cut from Candide, show up in West Side Story, and it's like, oh yeah, you can hear it. You can hear it in some of those songs. Like, yeah, that's definitely a West Side Story thing.
Well, and what is the one that they, what is the one I'm thinking of that is,
One Hand, One Heart, I think is the big one that comes over from Candide. There's another one. I think Krupke might have been a cut song too, if I'm not mistaken.
Interesting.
This is the melody, of course, but
yeah. Yeah, that's fascinating.
Okay, well, we get to Sheep's Song here then.
Sure.
You get to hear me bleat like a sheep here in a moment. But this is in the part of the show now. So they've made it to South America. I think they're in El Dorado. Or they're about to find out.
They've arrived in El Dorado now.
And Paquette is with Candide here at this point. But this is really the song from the sheep's perspective. It's really, because all the animals are singing. We're like in a Disney film at this point. Like all the animals.
Sheep and lion, depending on which version you're doing.
That's right. Get ready for this performance I'm about to put on. The first sheep sings, "Every sky is blue and sunny. Every face you see is glad. There's no greed or need for money or a synonym for bad." The second sheep goes, "Here each man is each man's brother. Here we sleep untroubled sleep. Each day is like the other. Even children never weep." So just as an introduction to this song, what does that do for you?
You know, it doesn't do a whole lot for me, to be honest. I think that the idea of singing sheep is really fun. And I think that it's just a little not funny enough for me to take up the time that it takes, especially since this is only part one of the full version. The one used in the Kristen Chenoweth and Patti LuPone production has a tightened version of this, which I think ended up being funnier to me.
I think that this works best. Like, this is a very performance dependent song. Again, talking about that humor, if you have someone who's going to ham it up and like really lean into this, like that's really what makes this song, I think, work more so than the actual lyrics themselves.
And as coming out of El Dorado, the song, and I know there are several versions of those lyrics too, or at least two different versions, but you've already had a song that talks about how what an idyllic world El Dorado is.
Yeah.
And then you have the sheep saying it again. And it's amusing the way they put it, and that it's coming from sheep's mouths, and the baas that are written in are fun, but it does feel a little redundant because it doesn't have a lot of laughs built in. It's just
Sondheim actually writes about this a lot, in that like if the audience has already understood what the song's trying to communicate, or she's just reiterating something that another character has already sang or said, it's kind of a waste of time to have that in your musical. Right? Because it's like, yeah, we get it, we know this, why are we taking 3 minutes to talk about this thing that we all already know about? And that's kind of what this song feels like to me. It's like, we know what El Dorado is, like we don't need to spend all
and
this
I'm
time.
I'm surprised that the lyrics don't have more of a punch in terms of a punch line, because they're cute, but you know, you don't find me criticizing his lyrics all that much, but this is a little bit unremarkable in terms of it, the wit of it, as and feels like a bit of a missed opportunity. Though again, I think it's a funny idea and it's amusing in a shorter version.
Yeah, I think that there's some interesting rhymes that kind of go on here, but I think you're overall correct in this. Like, Sheep Song is never going to be up there in like favorite Sondheim lyrics. Let's put it that way.
And I don't think, given how long the show is and how many options you have in the song list, I don't know that I don't think that the show needs this song at all. If you can, if it works for your production, great.
Well, we continue on because the lion sings, "Roses grow with ruby petals, humans grow with perfect grace. All is joy and precious metals. Surely there is no better place." Paquette sings, "Here each man is each man's brother. Here they sleep untroubled sleep. Every day is like the other. Very nice if you're a sheep."
Roses grow with ruby petals. Humans grow with perfect grace. All is joy and precious metals. Surely there's no better place.
Thank you. Enough.
So they're
fun. That's
yeah,
funny.
It's fun. It's fun. Yeah. But that's what I'm saying. It's like petals, metals, grace, place, brother, other, sleep, sheep. Like, so we're, it's not like the most complex of rhymes or anything like that, but there is like this nice rhythm that's going on here too. They don't seem forced, even though like they're almost perfect rhymes that are going here.
Yeah, absolutely. And it does fit into like a thematic pattern, I think, is observable in his work. Obviously this wasn't necessarily his conception as a song, but it fits with his outlook a lot in talking about things that seem like they would be perfect or wonderful but are actually not ideal for the people living through them.
Right. These people could actually be those optimists from before, because nothing bad ever happens here type
yeah.
of thing. Just to finish this off here then, so the lion goes, "Emerald leaves drip diamond flowers, silver cows give golden cream. People laugh and dance for hours." And Paquette finishes off, "If we don't leave soon, I'll scream." And then the two sheep come together to say, "Farewell, land of peace and order, where all pain and woe is past. Life awaits across the border. Au revoir, farewell, goodbye, at last."
Thank you on behalf of the listeners for your sheep work.
Thank you. I spent a lot of hours practicing that here this week, so I don't think we need to spend too much more time on this, because I do think it's kind of just like a throwaway, like it's not needed in this show. But if you are going to include it, yeah, get your performers to like go in there and like really lean into those bleats that are going on.
Yeah, it's very fun, especially I think for a maybe for a school or a community production too, where you're trying to give lots of people opportunities and you're going to beef up the comedy. I think there's definitely a way to perform and stage this to add to the humor. But the shortened version, I think, works just as well or better, which has only the, at least the shortened version I'm familiar with from that Bonnie Price production, uses just that first section of the sheep. And then Paquette and Candide exchange lines that are from the Hal Prince original version about, oh, it's perfect here. Yeah, perfect. Mm-hmm. Who would want to leave or whatever? I don't remember the exact lines. And then Paquette picks it up. There's no lion, and Paquette picks it up with all men or brothers.
Yeah.
And then they cut it, you know, they put it together with the cream line, the cows give golden cream or whatever. Each day is like the other. If we don't leave, I'll scream. So that's all very compact in there. And it does, the book sets up the joke of the lyric of I'll scream, and it works quickly. It's effectively, it gets a big laugh.
Yeah. In and out, right? You don't need to belabor the point too much.
Although then you have the actors dressed as sheep for all of they crawling around for just, you know, four lines of music. But
hey, They had to go to Juilliard for something, okay? So
they sure did. With that last part that you read, where they're saying farewell, I was confused in watching this Hal Prince reproduction video, because they don't explain before the sheep start singing the farewell verse, that they're taking them with them, or I think in some versions they're like packing gold onto them to travel with.
And then they just get stolen when they go to the sea captain.
And so they just go into this, you know, slow farewell verse that seems unnecessary. It's just them saying goodbye, but there's no funny business of them singing it while they're being stuffed full of gold and jewels or anything like that. So it, beyond what's already kind of a long and slow but amusing song, it's just a whole third longer than it was already, with no explanation of what's about to happen and no added comedy bits to the staging or the lyric. So that part, that's my least favorite part of the song.
Fair enough. For what it's worth, Sondheim writes this like tiny little paragraph after all these lyrics from Candide that he puts into his book, Look, I Made a Hat. He says, all in all, Candide was a happy experience, even though I was once again supplying just lyrics. Lenny's music was such a shower of delight that I actually had a good and easy time writing them. The deeper reason, of course, was that I had no emotional investment in it. It wasn't my blood on the line. It was a lark. So it's a way of saying basically, I did it for the money.
Yeah.
In a way. I mean, he probably wouldn't put it as trite as that, but I think that is true. I don't think that he was spending, you know, weeks and weeks and weeks agonizing over these lyrics. He probably wrote something that came to him and didn't do like massive rewrites and stuff like for one of his other more integrated shows.
I mean, what a nice position to be in, where lyrics as good as the ones he added just come so easily.
I know, and to work with Burns.
I mean, other than West Side Story, I feel like of the non-Sondheim shows, at least Candide has the most glorious music.
Yeah, I agree. Like,
whether you think it works as a show or not, whatever, but the music is just glorious.
Yeah, for me, I think it is like his opening, which does seem to get done the most out of all the songs that he wrote for the show. Life is Happiness Indeed is great. I really like that song quite a bit.
Yes, absolutely.
And all the other ones are like, yeah, put them in, I guess, if you want, but I don't know if they're like the most necessary to put in there either.
Yeah, I mean, and even rewrites, like, I think that he did the rewrites to Best of All Possible Worlds. Is that correct?
I don't know if that's confirmed or not, but
whoever did it, whether it was Bernstein or Wilbur or Latouche or Sondheim, I also personally prefer, I think the lyrics are funnier in the original version, which I know you haven't actually heard yet, but I just think that they hit me harder. Maybe it's because it's what endeared me to the show as a kid, and the wit of that dazzled my 15-year-old brain or whatever, and maybe it just isn't as functionally useful to the new plot or how they want it to flow. But yeah, some wonderful additions and some unnecessary ones.
No, absolutely. Well, Brendan, thank you so much for joining me here today.
Oh, my pleasure.
If people wanted to stay in contact with you online, is there a way for them to do so?
I like that idea that they're in contact with me now. there is a way. I am on Twitter and Instagram. My handle is at Brendan, please, BRENDAN, Brendan, please. And they can go there for some fun musical theater memes now and then.
Love it.
And whatnot.
I don't know if how much you can talk about it or not talk about it. Are there any upcoming shows or anything that you're going to be working on?
I think it would be much cooler to say, oh, I can't really talk about it. So we'll say that.
Sure.
The future has everything is possible.
That's right. And this Best of All Possible Worlds, everything is possible. So there you go. Thank you, Brendan.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks so much for listening. You can send emails to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. You can also follow Sondheim Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. And you can support the show on Patreon by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Thank you to the Alberta Podcast Network, to the Calgary Foundation, and to Park Power this week. Putting It Together is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere you can get podcasts from. Consider subscribing so that you never miss an episode. Next week is going to be an interview with Kurt Peterson, who, if you don't know, was the person who played Tony in the first revival of West Side Story on Broadway, as well as a host of other credits. He's an interesting person. Please don't miss that episode. I had such a fun time talking with him. As always, a big thanks to the great Chris Taniguchi, who designed the podcast artwork, and to Nick Driscoll for composing our theme music. Well, we've reached the end of our episode. Yes, I know. Goodbye for now.
Philosophers make evident the point that I have cited. 'Tis war makes equal, as it were, the noble and the commoner. Thus war improves relations.
Now Amor,
proving that this is the best of all possible worlds.
Love and kisses, the best of all possible worlds.